Red Blood Cell and Platelet Preservation, a Historical Perspective and Current Trends. In 1492, the first recorded blood transfusion involved Pope Innocent VII. The recipients and the donors all died. There were many obstacles that had to be overcome in transfusion therapy to get where we are today. A non-toxic anticoagulant had to be developed. We had to develop devices to perform the transfusion, such as needles and transfusion sets and tubing. Appropriate preservative solutions that maintain the donated blood for sufficient periods of time and making sure to avoid circulatory overload by setting infusion rates to allow the patient time to adjust to their fluid levels while the products are transfused. And the advent of component therapy, which allows us to give patients the specific product that they need instead of whole blood. In general, the AABB sets standards for transfusion medicine and donor collection. Usually the AABB and FDA requirements will align, although occasionally they will not, and you have to use the stricter standard. Most components are prepared from whole blood, but we also have the ability to collect most products via apheresis. The donation process involves the donors being given educational material that discuss blood-borne diseases and reasons you should not donate. The donor must complete a donor history questionnaire the day of each donation, and donor staff will then perform an evaluation of the questionnaire as well as an abbreviated physical examination. Red blood cell biology and preservation. There are three areas of red cell biology that are crucial for normal survival and function. First, the red blood cells membrane. Remember, we talked about how some people have membranes that are not as stable because they're missing some of their antigens. Then we need to have sufficient hemoglobin, and it should be of a normal functioning type. Then we have red cell metabolism. If there are defects in any or all of these areas, it will result in red blood cell survival that is less than the normal 120 days in circulation. That number again is 120 days. The red blood cell membrane represents a semipermeable bilipid layer supported by a protein mesh-like cytoskeleton structure. The membrane is made of a phospholipid bilayer with the hydrophobic regions facing each other and the hydrophilic regions facing outside the cell into the inside of the cell. There are integral proteins that go through the membrane and those that sit on the periphery of the membrane. The membrane must remain deformable to fit through small capillaries. Cells with hemoglobin S may not be deformable and they get stuck and cause strokes in the sickle cell patient. The red cell metabolic pathways are mainly anaerobic because the job of the red cell is to carry oxygen, not to use it up. The red cells are anucleated and have no mitochondrial apparatus for oxidative metabolism. The anaerobic glycolytic pathway is what is used. There are three ancillary pathways that serve to maintain the structure and function of hemoglobin. Hemoglobin's role in oxygen delivery to the tissues and carbon dioxide excretion. The hemoglobin oxygen dissociation curve is a sigmoid curve. There are allosteric changes that occur as hemoglobin loads and unloads oxygen. The tense form of hemoglobin is when it does not have oxygen loaded, and the relaxed form is when oxygen is loaded. The organic phosphate 2,3-DPG is important in the functioning of red blood cells. It becomes depleted in stored blood but quickly recovers after transfusion. There is a topic discussion on oxygen dissociation curve on eLearn. The next slide demonstrates what causes a right shift and what causes a left shift in the curve. This is your oxygen dissociation curve. The black line would be normal. A shift to the left is when hemoglobin is going to hang on tighter to the oxygen. So this is important in the lungs because we want the hemoglobin to grab onto the extra oxygen that is available. This means a higher affinity for the oxygen. Relaxed state, and a reduced delivery to the tissues. This is caused by a high pH, low temperature, low 2,3-DPG, decreased CO2, and in fetal hemoglobin, which allows it to pull oxygen from the mother's hemoglobin. If there is a high level of carbon monoxide, which means your hemoglobin is going to hold on to the oxygen and not let you use it, methemoglobinemia will also not allow you to release oxygen. Some hemoglobin variants will also hold oxygen tighter. So how are you going to remember what it makes it shift left and what makes it shift right? So what we're going to use is cont'd face right. C for carbon dioxide, A for acid, D for DPG, E for exercise, and T for temperature will make the curve go right and allow the hemoglobin to release the oxygen. So that in the lungs, we want a left shift, and in the tissues, we need a right shift. The goal of blood preservation is to provide viable and functional blood components for the patient who requires blood transfusion to increase their oxygen carrying capacity. The red blood cells must be maintained during the full storage period. The cells are refrigerated at 1 to 6 degrees Celsius to slow their metabolism so that they don't use up all the preservative solution too fast. The Food and Drug Administration requires that the average 24-hour post-red cell survival be more than 75% of the cells transfused and that the free hemoglobin is less than 1% of the total hemoglobin. Obviously, this is a difficult thing to measure, but the companies who create the preservatives are required to prove this before they are able to market the blood collection kits with the preservative solutions. So as long as you use FDA approved kits, then you should have the right thing. In the medical facility, the patient hemoglobin will be assessed after transfusion to determine if the patient received the expected benefit. The loss of the red cell viability during storage is called the lesion of storage, which is associated with various biochemical changes. The glucose will decrease because the cells are eating it. ATP decreases as energy is used. The 2-3 DPG levels decrease. The red cell morphology becomes more abnormal with echinocytes and spherocytes forming. The pH becomes more acid, and the free hemoglobin increases, and potassium also increases during storage. The anticoagulant and preservative solutions used in whole blood collection incorporate adenine, and this effect affects glycolysis and ATP levels. When blood is transfused, it initially has low levels of 2-3 DPG, which causes the stored blood to have a higher affinity for oxygen. This can increase cardiac output and decrease a mixed venous oxygen tension. However, this quickly reversed and the extra cells and hemoglobin create the oxygen carrying capacity of the patient and the 2-3 DPG becomes normal. The whole blood is initially collected with a preservative such as CPD, but a good portion will be lost when the plasma is removed from the packed red blood cells. After plasma is removed, the additive solution is added to the red blood cells, and this changes the expiration from 21 days to 42 days. The red cells are viable for a longer period of time, and the unit is less viscous because of the added solution. Currently, there are multiple additive solutions licensed in the United States. Adsol or AS1, made by Baxter Healthcare, Nutrisil or AS3, made by Paul, Optisol AS5, made by Terumo, Sol X AS7, made by Hemonetics Corporation. All of the additive solutions are approved for 42-day storage for packed cells. Freezing red blood cells is not a common practice. The U.S. military has large stockpiles of frozen blood cells, which can be utilized in the event of a large-scale war. Freezing blood for people with rare blood types or for autologous donation can preserve units for 10 years. The units must be cryoprotected and frozen within 6 days of collection. Glycerol is used most commonly and is added to the red blood cells slowly with vigorous shaking, enabling the glycerol to permeate the red blood cells. There is now an automated method for this procedure, as many units can be lost when performing the procedure manually. When red blood cells are frozen, they must be stored at minus 65 or colder. The freezers are generally set at minus 80 degrees Celsius. These frozen red blood cells can be stored for up to 10 years from the date of freezing. Training to process units to be frozen and to be thawed or deglycerized takes a lot of time. Units may be unusable if they are not properly prepared before freezing. Manual freezing and deglycerization requires a lot of man hours. Automated methods have been developed that are routinely used by the U.S. military. Manually thawed units must be used within 24 hours because it requires an open system. Thawed units using the automated method are closed system and have a 7-day shelf life. You must thaw and remove the glycerol called deglycerization. The glycerol removal is achieved by replacing the cryoprotectant with decreasing concentrations of saline. The freezing method must have tight QC controls and excessive hemolysis must be monitored in the wash supernatant. The osmolality of the unit should also be monitored to ensure adequate deglycerization is accomplished. Rejuvenation of red blood cells is a process by which ATP and 2,3-DPG levels are restored or enhanced by metabolic alterations. Stored red blood cells in the liquid state can be rejuvenated at outdate or up to 3 days after outdate, depending on the preservation solution used. Frozen cells are rejuvenated after deglycerization. This practice may be useful if you have an autologous unit that may outdate prior to a scheduled surgery and would allow you to use the unit. Much of the research and development of red blood cell preservation has been accomplished by the Military Blood Program Research Laboratory. In the military, an extended shelf life gives the military more time to move the units after they have been collected. The use of additive solutions has extended the shelf life of AS units to 42 days. There have also been processes designed to inactivate pathogens in plasma products, but this requires pooling of the products, which may increase the risk of contaminating a large number of units with a pathogen that isn't inactivated and has not been detected. Scientists have been working on a process to convert type AB to type O, but this is not approved. Scientists have also been working on trying to farm blood and red blood cell substitutes such as hemoglobin solutions. Again, these are not normally utilized because they are not approved. Platelets are stored at room temperature for a shelf life of 5 days post-collection, and they must be monitored for bacterial contamination, which could grow rapidly at the 21 to 24 degrees Celsius incubation temperature. Platelets are stored on a rotator inside a room temperature incubator. The rotation is designed to prevent activation and aggregation. They may release intracellular granules and ATP and ADP levels decline during storage. Quality control measurements are volume, platelet count, pH, residual leukocyte count if leukocyte reduced, and platelet swirl assessment, as well as testing for bacterial contamination. These tests are done at platelets at the end of their storage period. Platelets are used for treatment of bleeding associated with thrombocytopenia or low platelet count. Platelets can be given as a prophylactic treatment for hematology oncology patients with thrombocytopenia. We can prepare platelet concentrates from whole blood and then pull them to collect them or collect them via apheresis. The preferred method is apheresis, which provides a superior product and reduces the number of donors the patient is exposed to. The efficacy of the transfused platelet is estimated from the corrected count increment of platelets measured after transfusion. Platelets come from whole blood or apheresis and are stored at 20 to 24 degrees Celsius with continuous agitation for up to 5 days. All blood products expire at midnight. The date of collection is considered day zero. In the United States, platelets are being stored in a 100% plasma media unless a platelet activation additive solution is used. Maintaining pH is a key parameter for maintaining platelet viability in vivo. Platelet pH should not drop below 6.2. Newer generation storage containers have increased gas transport properties. One of the major concerns for platelets is bacterial contamination due to storage at room temperature. There is oxygen, which bacteria can use, and they grow better at room temperature. Bacterially contaminated blood products can cause septic shock or death. There is a requirement that all platelets are tested for bacterial contamination before they are transfused. There are FDA-approved commercial test systems that can be used to detect bacterial contamination. The samples for bacterial contamination are not taken for 24 hours to allow for any bacteria present to replicate to detectable levels. This means we lose one day that we cannot use platelets for transfusion. Thank you for listening.